Friends, this is the 35th and the concluding module in the course of History of Indian Sculpture, in which we are going to take a cursory survey of contemporary scenario. I'm Deepak Annal from Faculty of Fine Arts, MS University of Baroda. In this module, contemporary art practices and their characteristic features have to be discussed. It will be seen that ideas become more and more important in a work of art. An artist is often seen to use more than one medium to give expression to her or his thoughts. Art practices of few Indian artists whose works, or some of their works, can be put into the category of sculpture have been discussed. Even though all these artists use diverse mediums, including the audiovisual, some of their works, which can be called sculptures, have been discussed. Contemporary art practices in Indian context are seen delving into diverse mediums. Their essence is the concept of idea behind the work, which connects the whole body of work belonging to an artist. It is this concept of this search, rather than the style or medium, that becomes the common link for an artist. Artists react to global situation while finding roots in their home culture. There is a spirit of experimentation which goes beyond gallery space, size, tangibility, and inherent art material used by the artist industry. Contemporary is usually understood as postmodern or current trends in the art world. The term modern itself cannot be put into any fixed date bracket, and it differs from region to region. Contemporary art practices in India look at experimentation with different or essentially non-art material and the new media, while trying to address issues of this age relevant in our globalized world. They also try to find their inherent Indianness. Artists are no longer confined to a single medium and give expression to ideas in the medium best suited to their needs. Thus, it becomes hard to bracket artists as painters, sculptors, installation artists, or the new media artist. A single artist, more often than not, is seen to use more than one medium. Style and medium often take a secondary position and ideas take over. This is not to say that style does not operate or cannot be traced. The connecting link between a single artist's work becomes her or his concepts rather than anything else. Therefore, much individuality can be seen in the work of each artist. About contemporary Indian art practices and sculpture, Ranjit Hoskote writes that Vivan Sundaram, whose passage from the 1980s to the 1990s has also been one from painting to installation, erects memorials to historical decay and human endurance using the engineer's material, metal, engine oil, perspex. Ravindra Reddy's large terracotta and fiberglass heads, rye icons coated with gold leaf and pink paint, deliberately juxtapose high art with bazaar kish. Sudarshan Shetty's assemblages function as giant fairy tale toys, macabre cautionary tales, always precariously held together, threatened and threatening. Similarly, Kaushik Mukhopadhyay and Ellen Tallur rejoice in the anti-aesthetic impulse, demolishing the artwork as work of art and shifting the focus of viewing from product to process, emphasizing the nuts and bolts activity of the artist as inventor. They transfigure the contemporary and desacralize the iconic. Mukhopadhyay's work are located in the interval between the throwaway and the artifact. Tallur's in that between the gadget and the epiphany. By recovering the principle of play or leela, play as a serious principle of construction, operation and effect, play as the first move towards the creation of a parallel reality, these sculptors and sculptor installators create a space in which argument and theater, rituals and circus take place simultaneously. Received mythologies are interrogated and disputed in their work, while new and contemporary mythologies are brought into being. What results from these maneuvers is the formalization and democratization of the image. Himmat Shah, that way of the previous generation, who was born in 1933, studied at Baroda and was part of the group called 1890. The group's first and only show was in 1963, after which it dismantled. He then worked at Gari Studio in Delhi. Himmat Shah looks at the materiality of objects in his artwork and relates it to past and present. His artwork show his fascination towards archaeological excavations and objects found in them. Born in Lothal village in Gujarat, one of the sites of the Harappan civilization, Himmat Shah's long-term engagement with terracotta traces its roots to the place, seen especially in his sculptural series Heads. In his own words, he talks about the mystery that his artwork tend to create. Human being is an enigma, and what he creates should also be all enigma. Mystery should be everywhere, like the bird that slowly spreads his wings, revealing hidden colors as it does so, especially so in art forms. A piece of art is created because you allow it to happen. It cannot be forced. I am not creating. It is my hands that are creating. For when they have clay beneath them, I am lost. Next day, when I look at the creation, I wonder whether it was really I that had done this. For I had been totally lost as my hands had been shaping the clay. This state of creation, I consider the best form of expression or abhivyakti arising out of the deepest devotion or sadhana. Bala Nambiar, who was born in 1937, is a painter, sculptor, photographer, and academic researcher. His sculptural work can be seen in various materials like wood, bronze, steel, clay, and concrete. He has photographed and studied ritual performances like Thayam and Bhuta for his home state Kerala extensively. A large collection of his photographs was acquired by Indira Gandhi National Center for Arts, Delhi. Some of his sculptures are highly monumental and use architectural form. About Balan Nambiar, Shivaji Panikkar writes, Bangalore-based Balan Nambiar uses forms derived from the North Kerala performances tradition of Thayam. Often undertaking public sculptures on a monumental scale in material such as welded steel, fiberglass, and cement concrete. His symmetrical forms assume an airy lightness. A conversation or interview of the artist done by N. Pushpamala, who is another important sculptor, goes thus. Pushpamala asks him, Balan, your recent work, Valampiri Shankha, is a stainless steel image of a conch shell. What connection does the Shankha, which is an archaic Hindu religion symbol, have with the state of the art technology produced Texas Instruments, who commissioned the work? Balan Nambiar answers, you know, the first conch sculpture I made was in 1978 in the Portland cement factory in Heidelberg in Germany, where someone pointed out to me that it was based on the golden section. The golden section or the golden mean has a proportion of width to height of 1 to 1.618, which is supposed to be the perfect proportion and has been used extensively by Greeks and Renaissance artists and architects, which is a very interesting phenomenon. Dhruv Mistry, who is born in 1957, studied at Baroda, Baroda School of Art, where he later taught as well. Ratan Parimu, while talking about him, writes, Dhruv Mistry, one of the youngest of the Baroda sculptors, has revealed an extraordinary creative sense even during his student years. His work has anatomical accuracy, a formal purity, further enhanced by his sensitivity to light and caught by the sculptural forms. But more than his fitness of execution are Mistry's imaginative qualities. His works of the women with four breasts or the seated man with double right arm gives an uncanny sense of animation. The reality is made startling when man and chair coalesce so organically like the androgynous figure of Ardhanarishwar. Mistry's variations of female nudes within cubes are his other remarkable group of sculptures done in plaster. The nude is pressed within the cubic block while its limbs stick out from various planes. An erotic element is added by meticulous rendering of the curved buttocks from behind, which are made capriciously conspicuous by the contrasting straight edges of the cube. Another series of sculptures consists of enigmatic faces, heavy, long-necked, frontal, sinister, the latter quality ingeniously obtained in the ceramic heads by using the natural cracks which occurs in clay during the process of firing. In his recent work, he has turned to composite images comprising human, animal or bird parts, inspired by ancient Near Eastern and Indian art, executed in finished linear contours and smooth surfaces. Ravindra Reddy, who was born in 1956, according to him, most of his images come from everyday life. His extremely large female images and faces stare back at the viewer with big open eyes. Marks like a prominent red lipstick or bindi, combed hair are obvious in their social connotation. The images can be definitely be seen as transgressive and confronting male sexuality. Kamala Kapoor says, thus, while Reddy's art is rooted in the grand figurative tradition of Indian art, it is also original and contemporary. If one senses the pervasive presence of classical iconic sculptural tradition in his work, which designates spaces for circumambulatory and meditative viewing, there is also resistance offered in what soften iconoclastic and more relevant to the social and sexual politics of modernist discourse. The remarkable impact of these works depend on their urgency as images, on their historic and hierarchies. Images contain elements that are startling, exaggerated and even outrageous. Not quite creatures of fantasy and not quite social fact, neither metaphor nor violation, neither real nor allegorical. Ganesh Gohain, who was born in 67, migrated to Baroda after his graduation from Guwahati, Assam. His early work in Baroda was colossal images of human limbs painted in intense colors. His work gradually became autobiographical, using extremely personal references and elevating them to universal level. His sculptures like Letter to Father, Home Among Others, could reveal his phenomenon. I think the title of his earlier as well as the recent works, for example, Food from Baroda, The Missing Govardhana, My Table, Mirror, Poem, etc., hint at some implications, but they do not conjure up to any intended metaphorical connotation. His Letter to Father transcends not only the emblematic but also the metaphorical, probably because he does not start with a predetermined or preconceived meaning. He intuitively works towards an uncrystallized idea. For him, the method is as important as the result. It is like chanting a mantra, the act that has a fulfillment in itself. The outcome is deterministic, irrespective of the intentional and the accidental. Julia Kristeva envisages every signification as the dialectical interaction of the symbolic and the semiotic. The two forces competing for expression in the language of poetry or any art. The symbolic is the aspect that allows to refer tied to social order and logic. Semiotic processes predate the symbolic and are instinctual and maternal. The semiotic dimensions of language is the music of poetry that exploits the unintentional, involuntary, subconscious. In avant-garde art, Kristeva sees semiotic operations that she identifies with what she calls the polylogical subject. The polylog here refers to multiple logics and speeches both, revealing the nature of the dynamic significatory process which she believes is musical and material. It is the rhythm of the unconscious, but it is repressed and dematerialized in a signifying system when the expression leads itself to intentionality and specific objective. Ganesh does not work with objective, not even visual. He responds to his surroundings in visual terms, but necessarily drawing any inferences or conclusions. His work in his tangible rumination, which is instinctive, even indeterminate to an extent, it does not inevitably evoke the way he would want it to. Rather, it does not evolve at all, because evolution is condemned to be deterministic. Here, in this case, it blooms in the pre-linguistic ambit, evading the logic of signification. Sudarshan Shetty, who is born in 61, is a very, very significant sculptor who shifted from painting to sculpture, sculptural installations and multimedia works early in his career. He uses electronic media and likes to play with scale and multiplicity. Everyday objects, home, streets are used in his work to convey multiple meanings. He also works with memory, and his new work, Shunya Ghar, brings together architectural elements and objects belonging to extremely different and separated time periods together to form a single work of art. There is an audiovisual along with the life-size architectural forms. All these come together, and though presented as separate entities in a single space, can be viewed as a single work of art. Vaijayanti Rao writes, "Shetty belongs to a generation of artists who came of age in a time of exhaustion with the ideals of nationalism and socialism. Geeta Kapoor has described the politics of this post-liberalization generation as drawing from the realm of commodification, pleasure, and media images. She identifies a complicity with kitsch that produces a new understanding of politics different from the practices associated with an older generation of artists, and the moment of anti-colonial nationalism and global modernism. In this context, she argues that dissent appears camouflaged in parody and lightness. In a conversation with Rao, the artist says, "When I make an assemblage of one or more objects, the work always creates a world within itself. There is a relationship of a kind between the objects. So my quest is to be able to bring a work together in a way that you have never seen before. In order to reveal your own inferiority, perhaps you have to let go of something." Which comes back to the point that because I work with juxtapositions and ideas that look obvious and generic, this is a big challenge for me. I work with what is already available. That is what I refer to as memory at large. My work is not only about creating new images, but also about activating this memory at large, playing with what we already have and presenting it in a new way. Even if it has one degree of separation from what you may have expected or experienced, this is even more difficult as the visual field is so saturated and crowded today because of all kinds of influences. This is the major change that I have to work with. Subodh Gupta, one of the recent sensations in visual arts, who was born in 64, constantly tries to develop into the tensions between home and the world. His use of material, especially steel utensils, is symbolic of class aspirations as well as effects of new technology and new working class culture. Material and the kind of utensils are themselves symbolic of religion, Hindu lota or Muslim surahi, changing times with technology, coming of factories and mills post-independence, and stainless steel lunch boxes, working class culture. Migration too is a very, very important theme that keeps recurring in his work. Just as in the case of Hussein's painting, so many elements in Subodh Gupta's works come from his childhood. Gayatri Sinha writes, Subodh Gupta's narrative from obscurity to global success has already been apostatheosized as an Indian dream. Until the death of his father, Subodh's boyhood was dominated by the presence of the railway track. From the roof of their home in Khagol, in the heart of Bihar, the train lumbering into the yard meant that his father had come home. Alighting from the guard's cabin that stood next to the cargo van with its string, tied bundles, packets and good laden baskets. If the railways represented one aspect of India's modernity, their network linking village, district and town to city, the other facet was the modernity of his mother's kitchen. Stainless steel utensils that had been produced in low-tech factories in Nehru's India bore the imprimatur of the rhythm and labor of the Mofussil, the semi-urban India. Of the pungent heat of cowpat fires and the use of cow dung in purificatory rituals. By the early 2000s, Subodh as a sculptor, installation artist, had burst onto the Indian art scene. The familiarity and the formal elegance of his objects is complete disobedience to existing sculptural history. In fact, his work of the period, there is a complete lack of deference to anything that had gone before in Indian art. Historically, sculpture in modern India has been conservative medium. If painting has mirrored the swift shifts from nationalism to pop to the postmodern absorption of everyday, sculpture has remained entrenched in benign abstraction and some indigenous pop forms, best exemplified by Dhruv Mistry and Ravindra Reddy. Subodh brought to sculpture a certain social instrumentality, a monumental flair, and a hard-won success in interrogating the immediate within the universal. Pushpamala N, born in 1956, is one of the significant sculptors of this generation. Her early work, comprised of terracottas, handled very sensitively and depicting girls with chubby cheeks, dwarfish, like Pitalkhora Yaksha, engrossed in themselves, in childish and playful acts and grinning. The pig series, in which she portrayed those animals engaged in different activities, were modeled using clay slabs. Pushpamala was conferred the prestigious Triennale Award for one of these sculptures. But she chose to shift to medium of photography in 1990s. In her own words, which describe her terracotta art, Pushpamala says, "In my early sculptures, mainly in terracotta, I was interested in creating an indigenous language based on an essential idea of Indianness, using poor material and folk art references. A new language had to be used to express the sharp disjuncture and the fragmentation in the tumultuous realities around us." Ellen Tallur, born in 1971, studied at Mysore, Baroda, and then at Leeds Metropolitan University, London. Tallur's works come from everyday life. They are grounded in agricultural life, decaying images and things of the past. The materiality of the object in his works highlights the essence of his work further. It is in fact used most effectively and plays an important part in his work. Peter Nagy writes, "Mr. Tallur's artwork, primarily sculptures but also veering into expanded terrain known as installation, have as their foundation an eclectic approach which includes the traditional techniques of modeling, carving and casting, but also the more radical gestures of assemblages and appropriations. This polyvalent facility enables the artist to explore both ancient and contemporary dilemmas simultaneously. An astonishing fear, in actuality, throughout his production run the durable threads of well-considered content, but also an astonishing discernment in regard to formal attributes. So we, the viewers, must consider any number of possibilities when encountering his creations. History, theisms, concrete manifestations of the divine and ephemeral expressions of human desire, silhouettes, patinas, the transformation of forms through migratory paths of the inevitable decay of organic substances, even noise and tonnage as sculptural components packaged with a particular legerdemain that has come to be the artist's nom de plume to pit metaphors against one another, a Tellurian trait. One is initially seduced by Tellur's luxurious involvement with material stuff. Wood is burnished, scorched and oiled to produce brooding hulks and gleaming strides. Bronzes glisten with humidity, and animal fecundity is coaxed from concrete, acquiring a skin of lichen or putrid blooms. Metal are polluted with corroding salts, while the pitch of petroleum is used as theatrical makeup. We are in the salon of a couturier or an alchemist's lab, with a multiple material usually combined into a single work for an operatic effect. Mr. Tellur knows what he is doing. His art is reverently anti-digital, harking back to the grandiose expression of the 19th century, when European art extolled in a decadence of false historicism and Orientalist pastiche. The use of objects as metaphor in Tellur's works has been highlighted by João Ribas in his writing. These metaphors are complex and most often lend themselves to multiple meanings. Ribas, a senior curator who also teaches at various universities, writes, "Tellur approaches this transculturation through the use of literal object matter, solid metaphors of a sort as sculptural material, with an attention to what Rilke called the science or their concentrated reality. As such, an object within a symbolic field is transformed into an object of aesthetic labor within a new regime of signification. Though a metaphor changes to a material object itself. This is the key to the termite-eaten wood in the votive sculpture of Alzheimer's, made in 2006, or the transportable, inflatable lingam of Made in England, 2002. Thus, in Tellur's work, traditional and contemporary Indian symbols are present. Mutandis, the elephant, the jute grain sacks, Nandi figures, etc. The two current prevalent metaphors in his work are the digestive systems, an anthropomorphic metaphor of decay and consumption, and the souvenir itself, a kind of consumption of place and culture. In Souvenir Maker 2008, viewers are invited to operate a barbed wire making machine, producing a technology designed to assert property and boundary, to create a souvenir in the form of Indian milk bottles used to preserve gold-colored barbed wires. Tellur's object assembles of digesting system mines the metaphor of consumption through its literal and metaphoric overtones of the body. In the same way, the autochthonous can be said to be digested through the re-territorializations of capital. It is precisely here that the productive power of the untranslatable returns, enforcing the way, in the words of Henry Lefebvre, the worldwide does not abolish the local. Tullu's work evinces how material, meaning and metaphor can preserve, never be fully consumed. Much as words, even in their plentitude, can never do justice to the image, pictures are hardly even worth their proverbial thousands of words. There is an inherent inappropriateness, a totalizing absurdity in the attempt at such translations. In the very hearsay of that paraphrase, not a thousand, but not a few, not an infinite, nor perhaps any words. Rather, it is the slippage between what can be said and what is represented or meant. In that chasm between word and things standing as the horizon of meaning, that elides brute factility of the world into the most vivid images of it. The contemporary spirit has engulfed even the regional and the smaller schools of art. A large number of sculptors from younger generation have been doing extremely sensitive and meaningful work, but unfortunately, considering the present constraints, it may not be possible to take note of all of these.